elect of Kogi State, and it is believed that he's not going to have it really very smooth, as we have a lot of issues characterizing his declaration as the next governor of Kogi State. We have a Abiona Falike's camp still saying, yesterday we got information that James Falike has gone back to the House of Assembly to go and resume his legislative responsibility. And so it simply means that we don't have a deputy governor for Kogi State as we speak. And so, I mean, so we'll be talking about Kogi's elections because some new things, you know, happened yesterday that will make us have a build up. I don't know what it is like with fuel scarcity in your area, but I mean, the barrister said it seems to be receding. I mean, people are beginning to see lighter queues in the filling station. That means if we go by the instructions or the statement of the Minister of Information, Alhaji Lai Mohammed, that give us a few days and these queues will disappear. And it seems to be playing out almost immediately. So we definitely will be coming. I know you're a very ardent and uncompromising, you know, follower of the current government and all of that.
We should be able to take the
I don't want to go there now. Let me finish my update, Ishama. Okay. Now, fuel scarcity. Now, and then we definitely will not leave out a couple of trending stories that we have already, you know, put out there to be discussed on the show. Now, let's quickly take those things, those stories making headlines, and then we come back to these full stories as we update you on some of the events that has been taking place over the last weekend and up till now, the midweek. Now, troop intercept fleeing Boko Haram terrorists, and this happened yesterday. Now, Nigerian troops have intercepted and killed many Boko Haram terrorists while trying to escape the onslaught of at the Sambisa Forest. Now, in a statement, the acting director, Army Public Relations, Colonel Sani Usman, said the insurgents were decisively, countered while trying to escape through Polka. Now, he said many of the terrorists were killed during the encounter, while one of them was captured alive. Colonel Usman said the soldiers also recovered a general purpose machine gun, several rounds of ammunition, 47 rifle magazines, and 36 hand grenades, and a number of silica guns, empty shell. Now, Ishoma and Barrister Adetola Kazim, I quickly want you guys to help me, you know, in my thought. I keep having a feeling that information that is being put out here, especially on the fight, you know, against terrorism in Nigeria, especially the war against Boko Haram, to be, I mean, and don't forget, we have a December deadline that the president has issued to the military and the joint forces, that by December, Boko Haram should have been chased out completely from Nigeria. Now, let us, first of all, I want to find out, do you think this is possible? If you think it's possible, is it possible in December? If it is not possible, what are the options that we have? I mean, these are some of the questions that I know a lot of people are asking, and they probably want analysis on them or other opinions, I mean, which we do, you know, on Crossfire. Now, I mean, that's just what I want to know, because today is the ninth day in the month of December. And believe you me, I mean, you and I know that December is just the month that comes, and, you know, once we approach, exactly, once we approach, you know, the Yuletide dates and all of that, where celebrations, people get totally distracted, and then the days goes by. Now, what is your take on the fight against terrorism in Nigeria?
My take is that I think we are not hearing all the truth, because we keep hearing in the news that the troops have captured so-so, people have killed quite a number. You wonder, where are the others coming from? In some days' time now, I hope that would not happen. But what we have seen in the past is that they say the troops killed so-so-so number, and the next day, the Boko Haram insurgent killed more than what the troops have killed, and you wonder, where are these people coming from?
But don't you think that is due to the recruitment process, and also because we have a lot of illegal borders, you know, within the country where they also infiltrate from?
But these borders are being manned today.
Illegal borders. And for them to be illegal,
sure,
that means
they're
not manned.
The entire territory of the Nigerian borders are manned today.
Statistics show that we have over 1,400 illegal borders.
Yes, they are actually poor. We have porous borders. Mm-hmm. There's no doubt about that. But the truth is, what I'm actually saying is that there are a lot of propaganda going on, particularly from the part of the Nigerian army. Or they are doing well. I believe they are doing a lot. I believe they are actually killing. But sometimes they beef up some of the story just to look good. That is my feeling.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so
just to look good.
So does that mean
media.
We cannot win the war come December?
I doubt we can win the war. I doubt we can win the war. Mm-hmm. I seriously doubt we can. From what has happened in the past, I doubt we can win. I believe we win the war. I hope, as a Nigerian, that we win the war. But I doubt that is achievable in December. I'm sure the government will come and beat for more time.
Hmm. Anyway, like I say this, barrister, I say this quite often, and I want to use this platform again to emphasize and probably to be clearer. I know Ishoma is a Christian, and I am one, and I know that you are Muslim. Do you think this operations, activities, intentions, ideology of the terrorist group, I mean, talk about the ISIS of this world, and then let's come back home and talk about Boko Haram. Don't you see there's a very wide gap between what we have always known Islam to be and what these people proclaim to have, to be portraying?
I think there are a lot of propaganda out there. Mm-hmm. You understand? Generally, an average Muslim is not a terrorist.
Mm-hmm.
But we hear a lot of things. When you look at what happened in Paris, news coming after the incident shows that from what we have been made to know in the media, there are a lot of falsehood there.
Mm.
There are pictures on media that have shown this person in hijab was the one responsible. And you see somebody coming out to refute. This is the real me. I'm not the one out there. So we hear a lot of things that are actually not true.
Not true.
I know some time ago, somebody was captured who was a Christian, or by name was a Christian, and that person was about bombing a church. So there are a lot of things. It's a lot of mix. So it's not clear-cut.
We should not play religion with the activities of these guys.
Playing religion makes our search restricted.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You start looking for Muslims whereas somebody out there is just,
who belongs to other religions.
Other religion or no religion at all. Is trying to foment trouble. Mm-hmm. Just like you have troublesome Muslims, you have troublesome Christians, you understand? When you look at some countries, when you look at, what was this man's name? This man from Norway, who killed about 77 people, Breivik. Who killed about 77 people, you understand? Because of his Christian faith. You understand? But when, you find in media, when a Muslim does something, you say a Muslim terrorist. But when somebody is a Muslim, there are other names. You hear a gunman, and I think there is stereotyping, which is bad and which is defeating the war against.
While I know that Donald Trump's comment is just something that is. I think what he wants is that he wants to draw attention, to himself, and unfortunately, it's a very bad attention that he's drawing. Yesterday was making a classical statement, in one of his campaign and saying there would be, a movement of Muslims into the United States of America will be restricted and all of that. And up till this morning, you could see enough of, challenges. And to a very large extent, you would have expected that probably there would have been, uproar in some quarters to refute, to fight, and to probably make him come out to come and apologize for making such a statement. It has been calm. And people have been addressing the press and saying, he is a joker. He cannot be serious.
Unfortunately, lots of Americans also have been supporting his claim. I mean, CNN showed videos.
People
of
who
people
are the politicians
taken to the streets,
his followers.
Who are supporting him?
Yes.
His followers.
I think I read somewhere that is those followers are poor illiterates.
Yes, now.
That is, because if you want to get hold of people, or if you want to control people, just keep the books away from them. You understand? Keep education away from them. So anything you say, they are like what is going on in some part of the country, in the East. You understand? This clamor for Biafra and the likes. If you find out that most of those clamoring for it are the less educated people. But because
I don't see somebody who is a banker, who is supposed, all the problem at Onitsha, you couldn't possibly blame it on somebody who has a job, who is gainfully employed, or who has a business concern that is running, will go and stay for 4 days, 5 days,
blocking, on the bridge.
But Mr. Akintola, don't you think this poses a big problem you know, for the world today, because if you look at it across every continent, there's this form of ethnicity or there's this form of religious affiliation that people, they try to tie everything to. People try to cling to. It's either that you're being judged by your skin color because you're black, and then some certain benefits cannot get to you. And then it's either, on the other hand, people look at a religion also. But don't you think, is there a way we can get away from this today? Is there a way we can get away from this? And if yes, then what is the Muslim community coming out strong to do to refute, you know, the affiliations, you know, which people are tying terrorism to Islam?
You know, the one of the major problems is that Muslims or Islam generally do not control the mainstream media. If you control the media, you control people's opinion. And that is one of the first major issues. People are talking.
But Al Jazeera, I mean, some people may say that Al Jazeera can come in here because of its affiliation also, in terms of those it appeals more to.
It comes in, but it's Al Jazeera against CNN, against BBC, against Fox News, against... Al Jazeera is just one.
Yeah, but you can be one.
No, no,
you can be one.
What I'm saying is that they're trying their best. You understand? And Muslims on social media will come out and say, but people will listen to what they want to hear. So people are actually listening to news saying Islam is a terrorist group. Because we see that the competition, Islam versus Christianity versus the Jews, Judaism, and the likes. So we want to hear, we want to hear what we want to hear.
So no matter how much of a balanced information that you have out there, people will just
Some people will still stand on points they feel is favorable to them.
Exactly. Now, I mean, that being as it may, it's just on the side.
On the side.
I keep talking to my, you know, to my Muslim brothers. I'm born by, you know, by a Muslim mother, and I tell people that what she taught us when we were growing up is far from you associating, you know, Islam to, I mean, some of these things.
For instance, I served in the East, and I served in a Christian, only Christian community. I did a lot of projects. I was the best core member for my set. If I'm a Muslim and I can do things for Igbos, I established a skills acquisition center, did things for widow, provided wheelchair for disabled. I raised money from Lagos and took it to the East. If I'm a Muslim and I can do all this, I'm a lawyer and I do a lot of, I have an NGO which deals with prisoners and those who are unjustly. And I can tell you that most people are freed. They are more Christians than Muslims. You understand? That is what Islam preaches.
It's a religion of peace. I mean, it's just really very important that we use all our social, all our media platform, not social media, but, you know, only. I mean, the electronic, the print media, we should use it well for effective communication and to use it as a very, you know, robust platform to disseminate, you know, balanced information, the type that will not incite, you know, people to do exactly, to do what they're not meant to do. Anyway, truth is just that. We will give the military enough time, and we will watch. You see, because we, but the truth
but
is just that we cannot
that
just sit down and
it's
watch.
It's not just about giving the military enough time. Yes, we should give them enough time, but as citizens of Nigeria, what role are we also playing to ensure that we win the war against terrorism?
How do we do it?
It's
I can't carry a gun.
No, but we cannot carry guns. It's against the law of the land. But the thing is, as regards gathering security information and all of that, we can make those available to security agencies. If we can give them the kind
of
information...
That's if we have
out.
An information at all. Let me
and,
tell you what has
also,
happened.
And also, this, and if you are sure of security. Because sometimes you find out that they are actually informants within the security agencies.
Exactly.
You understand? So there are a lot of things. So you have to, one has to be careful. You're trying to protect. Though some people can be very brave. Some of us can be very brave. But an average Nigerian would look after himself first.
Say human.
You understand? So those are some of the issues.
Now, another very important thing to note is that, I mean, I worked with one of the telecoms giants, and I know that telecommunication infrastructures have actually been affected by the insurgency in the Northeast. So most communications are not actually done by phone in those areas. It simply is an indication that there are some very, very powerful gadgets that even Boko Haram has gathered. You know, and they've been using this as a means of communicating, you know, to themselves in movement and everything. And don't
Whereas
forget, they have walkie-talkies.
do not have that.
Exactly, you know. Hmm. And then you don't have that, you know, maybe the military really well armed with all of this communication information.
And people and do not even have information of who to communicate to. Mm-hmm. So those are the issues.
So they don't have numbers. The military should have probably a toll-free number or a customer service number. Let
definitely.
Me put it that way.
Yes.
Where people can reach and...
Yeah, that's one. And then, I mean, you guys are lawyers, and you know how very much the back of a whistleblower is opened. Mm. There is no support and there is no protection for witnesses.
Definitely.
I mean, you do it's at your risk. I mean, you come out and say, yes, I know about
that
it.
That is one of the reasons why people rather die with information they have.
Yes, definitely.
They
won't
make
it. And now it appears to be becoming stiffer.
Yes, now.
With the proposed... anti-frivolous petition bill, commonly known as social media.
And the social media bill. All right, let's quickly go on a short break. Now, when we come back, we still will be talking to Mohammed Adetola Kazim, and we definitely will be narrowing down talking about the social media bill because, I mean, he's got a lot of findings that he has done in this particular thing, and he will make out and put out those information out there for everybody's use. Let's go now. We'll be right back.
So, did you like what you just saw? I know you did. Mm-hmm. It's very simple. If you want to see more, just subscribe to our channel right now.